Oh, the fire festival, I saw it. Did you see the fire festival? I mean, you told me about it. Okay, so regarding the fire festival, I saw it on Netflix, so I already know what happened and all the details, but I want to see how he explains the story. I don't know if you saw the fire Netflix documentary. It's like so good. It have like so many fucking details. I don't know if it's a movie or if it's in different episodes. Oh, I need to rewatch this. Oh, sorry.
Hi there. You're probably wondering how I got this tan. Well, let me tell you the story. It begins with a man by the name of Billy McFarland. Billy was a good boy. At 22, he had dreams of becoming a super wealthy entrepreneur, dropping out of college to start a business called Magnesis. Over the years, he managed to network with some powerful people. One of them was Ja Rule. Translated from German, I believe it means, yes, rule. Over drinks, he pitched an idea. Here's an accurate recreation of that event.
Mr.
He
Rule,
was just scamming people, right? Even with his very first business.
Like, what happened? I'm like, yo, this thing's too wild. It's fucking a bitch.
Precisely. Great minds think alike. It will be 2 weeks of absolute luxury in the Bahamas. Mr. Rule. Promotion began in late 2016. Fire promised beaches, ladies, gourmet food, luxury villas. Hosted on a private island in the Bahamas called Fire Cay, once owned by Pablo Escobar. VIP tickets up to $250,000. Swimming pigs. Blink 182. Major laser. A steel drum. Welcome to Fire Festival. The best two damn weeks of your life. I bought my ticket immediately. The day arrives. About 5,000 people are making their way directly from Miami Airport, and there are huge delays to get to Fire Cay. Although I shouldn't say Fire Cay, because it doesn't exist. In the marketing, they referenced this island, which is actually Norman's Cay, run by George Young, not Pablo, by the way. But that doesn't matter, because we're not going there either. We're going to Great Exuma. Private island? Forget that. Population, 7,000. In fact, we're basically in the parking lot of a Sandals
That's
resort.
Already a pretty big lie.
In the end, only about 500 of us make it to the island. The remaining customers' flights are cancelled. You're about to see why. We're hauled onto a school bus and taken to the site. A gravel lot with a bunch of FEMA tents.
Oh no!
Remember those promises of luxurious villas? Pranked ya. Enjoy your stay, and don't forget your complimentary
oh
cup of UNICEF.
Oh my god, it's so bad.
Once there, no one knows whose tent belongs
Drift
to
Island,
whom, so start by getting everyone
oh,
into a line.
It's so expensive.
Then they abandon that idea and tell everyone it's a free-for-all. Expecting a party, this guy took all of his drugs on the flight over. He's the only one having any fun. Everyone else is grumpy because it's been 5 hours and there's no food. In lieu of food, staff decide to start handing out tons of free tequila. This only exacerbates problems. Once the food does arrive, it's just as delectable as promised.
Oh yeah, it's really
Gourmet
bad.
Craft
and
the
vegan was posted on Twitter.
A few
yeah.
hours later, bags arrive on a shipping container. It was getting dark and there was no lighting.
So everybody's walking around with their cell phones trying to look for their luggage. Oh,
plenty of people had their luggage stolen. But don't worry, if you have any valuables, the festival advertised top-notch security.
Oh,
here it
shit.
Is. But no one told guests they had to provide their own lock. There are rumors of muggings by the locals.
I heard rumors of feral dogs.
A tent supposedly caught fire. The closest beach has a rampant shark problem. Staff don't have any uniforms or walkie-talkies, so no one knows who's in charge, and the people who are in charge can't talk to each other. Here's the bathroom. Many staff quit after only a couple of hours.
Oh my god.
For the few customers who are willing
to just
make the
most
of it
and enjoy
the music, they had some bad news too. All of the major musical acts pulled out. In fact, Major Lazer wasn't even confirmed to go in the first place. The event was promoted as cashless, so all people had were these useless Disney bucks on their fireband, which meant they couldn't buy anything or catch a cab if they were stranded.
Oh
and even with
God.
Only 500 people, there are too few tents and beds, so everyone is just stealing each other's. And for any of you thinking you could just escape to the Sandals, bad luck. It's peak season and they are absolutely full. People are reaching out to the embassy for help. After a few hours, most people chose to go back to the airport, and the rest were forced back home when the Bahamian government stepped in. The festival was closed. But the exodus from the island made its own problems. Guests spent hours dehydrated and hungover in a hot building.
Oh, yeah.
Why staff locked the door isn't entirely known. But one girl fainted before they were finally reopened. Everyone gets home, and that was the end of it. Except for me. I was rescuing someone, helping them out, and I got lost in the woods. Anyway, back at home, the shitstorm on social media was just ramping up. The Reddit R Fire Festival was created, and it started documenting everything that went wrong at the event. People were circulating a fake tweet by Jar that the whole thing was a social experiment. Some wholesome festival memes there. And it quickly turned into a marketing case study of what not to do. In response, Fire started serving cease and desist letters to stop people from saying mean things about them. Mr. Rule released an official statement online, both apologizing and saying that it's not his fault. Interestingly, he wasn't even on the island at the time. He was giving a concert in Chicago. Although, to their credit, they offer everyone a full refund. Or, you could always let it ride and opt in for tickets to 2018's Fire Festival.
And a VIP ticket to next year's Fire Festival.
Next year?
If they decide to go.
Really?
Exactly.
Next year?
Meanwhile, Billy is on full damage control. He claims that a storm came in the night before and changed all of the marketing into lies.
We got to a point that we were very excited about.
You're fucking liar.
With how the two sites looked, and we got hit by a big storm.
But the apologies weren't enough. A few days later, and the first lawsuit was served.
Attorney Ben Mycelis doesn't think it's funny. He's filed a $100 million class action lawsuit against the organizers.
Then another suit. Then seven more. Then the feds got involved, claiming Billy had committed wire fraud, serious charges with serious prison time. More on that later.
But first,
right now, let's go into the history of Fire Festival. The marketing was clever. To get the word out, they got in touch with about 400 influencers, Instagram celebrities, and they offered them VIP tickets or cash to promote the event. They even managed to get Kendall Jenner to post about it. Rumor has it she was paid $250,000 for this post. Their marketing worked,
though. God.
The festival sold out. So how did it go so wrong? Let's start with the money. During the planning process, a consultant came in and said the festival would cost $50 million and require another year of organization.
They should have planned this 2 whole years out.
This is after they made all the promises, and they had nothing near that amount, so they started cutting expenses way back. Remember those luxury villas? They were going to cost $10 million alone, so they scrapped them. Aww. Now everyone gets a tent. Deposits for the bands? Nope. Food, infrastructure, staff, all were cut back. But, you may ask, how did they have so little cash if they sold out? It's the price. It was way too low. Now, wait a minute. Up to $250,000 a ticket is too low. In fact, on social media, people were so merciless and unsympathetic towards the guests because they thought it was a bunch of rich kids paying for tickets with a starting price of $12,000. And you can thank fake news for that assumption. You see that number repeated everywhere. But actually, very few were paying even close to that amount. The standard price was around $1,200. Which, if you think about 2 weeks in the Bahamas with practically all of your expenses taken care of, that's pretty bloody good. In fact, some tickets were as low as $500.
6 months ago, got together and got the early bird special for about $500. And this covered food, transportation, ticket, and somewhere to sleep.
How on earth were they gonna break even with that? They weren't. And on the flip side, there's no proof whatsoever that anyone purchased a $250,000 ticket. So basically, they're stuffed. Billy has to start taking tough short-term loans just to keep afloat. Which, by the way, is why they did the fire bans. It was to raise cash. It's reported that up to $2 million in Firebucks in-game currency was spent in the lead-up to the event.
Oh.
But this wasn't even close to enough. Practically broke, and with the event only a few weeks away, the more experienced staff suggested postponing. But thanks to those short-term loans, he couldn't. So he insisted on going forward. Those staff tried to control the damage by telling celebrities and public figures not to go.
How was the fire festival?
So, Billy and Jar are in some serious trouble. But, let's please have one failed festival that has a sequel. Well, Billy is out on $300,000 bail. His assets were frozen as at May 18th. He dropped his expensive attorneys. He's selling his property in New York. He tried to sell Magnesis for $150,000, but it was cancelled for being fraudulent. Massively in debt and with no hope of paying it back, Fire went into involuntary bankruptcy. And that is the end of Fire Festival. I'll keep you posted about whether Billy is going to jail. So long, Fire Festival. You were too beautiful for this world.
Oh, it's so short. There's just a lack of detail. I would like recommend you guys to watch the documentary on Netflix. It's just so much more. It's so funny. It's like, if you like drama, Fire documentary on Netflix is so fucking good.